Warning, Ghosts of Saltmarsh, spoilers ahead. After almost a year apart, Dagg the goblin bard, Murithi the human rogue, Bells the kenku monk, and Fargas the dwarf cleric run into each other in the streets of Gibna, the hobgoblin-controlled capital city of the region. During the party's collective downtime, Dagg performed at a local inn and netted himself some extra money. Murithi is broke, but has several new criminal contacts in the city. Bells has been making potions the entire time. Talk about being prepared. Lastly, Fargas has been helping out at a local temple in typical do-gooder cleric fashion. Dagg saunters up confidently, eyeing everyone up and down.
What's up, bitches? I'm wealthy now.
Yeah, the clothes look the same.
Ouch. Dagg turns around and sulkily tunes his lute. Ooh, close to home, eh? If you've ever learned anything about Dagg, please let it be that he gets pushed down, but is rarely ever out. While accompanying Bells to the apothecary for a few additional ingredients, never mind that she has been making potions this whole time, Dagg wastes no time getting back to his usual antics.
Hey, Fargas. I wrote a poem for you.
Oh, did you know?
It's called To Fargas. From the Everlasting. Your face looks like a ton of bricks. Like an ugly ton of bricks. Your god hates you. He told me privately. And he told me to deliver these kicks.
Dagg then quickly throws a kick at Fargas, who deftly dodges.
You're gonna reject your god's kicks, eh? Your god told me you needed these kicks in the-
Ah, Dagg, I've missed you. Come here, you wee rascal.
Fargas grabs Dagg and gives him an aggressive head patting. Dagg makes his body go limp and falls to the ground, prone. His body is jello. No time to be sleeping on the ground, Dagg. Bells, however, has gained no additional patience for these antics over the year she hasn't had to deal with them. She turns around irately,
no lollygagging,
and keeps walking.
Hey, so guys, some schmuck just handed me a letter addressed to the four of us from a guy named Vertek.
The letter reads,
adventuring. Come to Vertek's house. Vertek needs adventurers to do task for Vertek. Bring letter and self. Signed, Vertek.
The party arrives at an elaborately decorated mansion. Flanking the front door are marble pillars topped with Corinthian pilasters. Stone gargoyles screech as they attempt to flee the walls, while an algae-covered stone fountain carved to depict a warship sprays water from its six side cannons. Surrounding the fountain is a garden that has grown wild, showing signs of both age and neglect. Bushes obscure several garden paths that have been reclaimed by grass, moss, and dirt. Fruit trees are surrounded by dead fruit, and ivy threatens a nearby birch. The party approaches the oak door and stops. The door bears a bronze knocker in the shape of an elaborate, cursive A.
Hey, Fartgas, go knock on the door.
Bells. Would you mind doing it for me?
Bells hates doors. I mean, this girl hates doors so much she would destroy the door to her room given half the chance. I suppose I'm the guilty party behind this. From a previous episode, the party was trapped in a vampire castle that had a lot of locked doors. I mean, it was a truly excessive amount of locked doors, and I should have quietly changed a few, or perhaps most of them. Bells pounds the door so hard it rattles in its frame, sending loud reverberations through the foyer. The door flies open and a well-dressed half-orc appears.
Who knocks so hard at Vertek's house?
"'Twas I, Dagg the Everlasting.
"'Twas hard knock for Goblin. Come in, come in.
It turns out this is not Vertek's house, but rather it belongs to a down-on-his-luck merchant named Aubrek. The interior of the house has seen better days. The walls forlornly bear faded paint and dusty portraits, while the air itself smells slightly musty. The marble flooring, however, is clean. It is quite possibly the only thing in the house that is maintained. Despite the lackluster interior, Aubrek is fairly well-dressed, but years of stress have taken their toll. Barely 30 years old, his salt and pepper hair suggests he's past his prime. The guy could use a vacation, though it's hard to feel bad for the wealthy in distress.
Thank you all for coming. Sit, relax. Let's talk business, eh?
Dagg has been totally ensorcelled by the wealth contained in this house, and you can see the gears turning in his little goblin head.
Do you perhaps need a musician to patronize, or who can provide you with sexual favors in exchange for living in this fancy house and wearing these fancy clothes?
Not sure about the favors, but fortune be good, I may need a musician or two.
Well, as long as you're not sure, we can leave things open for interpretation later.
Albrecht looks slightly uncomfortable, but sends Vertag to get everyone a drink. Vertag dashes out of the parlor and returns a few moments later with red wine and cold, clear water. Everyone takes wine from the tray except Bells, who takes no chances. That drugged feast in the vampire castle has made her more paranoid of strangers offering food and beverage. Dagg casts minor illusion on Fargas's drink and makes it appear as if it's on fire. Fargas yelps and heaves the cup across the room while Dagg cackles uproariously. Albrecht, while amused at these antics, gets down to business. He wants the party to head to a derelict, abandoned wreck of a ship he lost several years prior that contains very valuable cargo that only he, Albrecht, can use for profit. The reward is a flat 10,000 gold for returning the chest, and Albrecht will charter a ship to and from the wreck at no additional cost. Despite the party's reservation about the seaworthiness of the recently sighted ship, the party takes the quest, and away they go! After leaving Albrecht's mansion, the party walks through the crowded streets of Gibna until they reach the docks. Albrecht's commissioned ship is called the Soul of Winter, captained by a dwarf named Wolfgar. It's fairly easy to find. What dwarves lack in size, they compensate with weapons, armors, and shouting. In this particular instance, the party hears a dwarf screaming hysterically at his crewmen. The party walks right up to the ship and the hysterical figure turns towards them, ready to begin a new tirade.
Eh! Who are you?
Oh goody, another Scotsman.
Bells fires back a perfectly mimicked,
Hey, who are you? I'm Captain Wolfgar. Who are you, Birdman?
I'm Captain Daggar.
Not captain of my ship.
This is my ship.
No, it isn't.
Dagg takes the amount of time you'd expect him to and tries to deceive Wolfgar into thinking he, Dagg, is the actual owner of the ship. Some things never change.
It was given to me. Do you not remember that, Wolfgar? We gambled last night when we were drinking. You gave me your ship.
I don't drink at port.
Yes, you did. You did last night.
Goblins, get off of my ship.
Your mother's name is Mary and your father's name is Heathcliff.
What?
How would I know that unless we had spoken last night at the tavern?
Fargas intervenes on Wolfgar's behalf, saving Dagg from getting thrown into the water. The ship departs within the hour, and the day passes quietly to the gentle sound of the waves and the cawing of seagulls. The party keeps their distance from one another for the first day. Introverts unite! Bells climbs the mast and settles in the crow's nest, and why wouldn't she hang out there with a name like that? Murithi and Fargas rest in their cabins while Dagg is himself. You'll see. Albrecht has sponsored a small armory designed to outfit the party with armor, weapons, ammunition, rope, grappling hooks. You get the picture. It's clear this cargo is worth every copper to him. Murithi and Dagg actually get an armor upgrade, and I'm not sure it's a good or bad thing that their previous armor was worse than what Albrecht offers. The trip to reach the Emperor is 3 days' time, but don't worry! Dagg is always up to something to keep himself entertained while simultaneously working towards a random secret goal. At the end of the first night, Dagg pulls out many pieces of fabric and leather as he starts fervently working on a new project. The sun rises and Dagg emerges from his room, dressed to the nines in his new captain's outfit. This particular outfit is tailored to match Wolfgar's garb almost perfectly, much to the dwarf's chagrin.
Oh, perfect. It fits great.
Dagg spends the entire day following Captain Wolfgar around the ship, copying everything Wolfgar does, but giving conflicting orders just after Wolfgar gives an order. This goes over about as well as you'd expect. Here are a few examples.
Ah, scrub the deck. What are you doing sitting on your ear?
Ah, shit on the deck. It's too clean.
Hey, you, rig the sails.
Hey, take those f***ing sails down and throw them in the garbage. They're ugly. They don't have any pictures on them.
A random dwarf looks up from what he's doing, eyeing the captain and Dagg before he looks at the blank sails. Wouldn't it be nice to have a little something on the sails, eh, Captain?
You, goblin.
You, Garfield. Your job today is to paint the sails. Draw a picture of your mom, draw a picture of your hometown's best statue, whatever. The f***ing sails needs pictures on them.
To those amazed that Dagg wasn't thrown overboard, being a nuisance is different from being malicious. However, Wolfgar has had enough of Dagg sh** and has four guards take Dagg back to his room to lock him in. Not that that mattered.
Dagg waits until the dwarves leave before he picks the lock on his door, grabs his bagpipes, and goes back onto the deck to follow Wolfgar around. Every time Wolfgar reaches for something, Dagg plays the highest possible note on his bagpipes, causing screeching squeals to echo out over the open sea.
Enough already!
Dagg runs away, cackling, and a bunch of the dwarf crew members are grinning at his antics. However, Dagg decides to lay low for the rest of the day, having expended a lot of energy tormenting Wolfgar. What has everyone else been doing? Not much. Bells has been up in the crow's nest since she got on the ship, Murithi's been in her bunk, and Fargas has been talking with some of the dwarves about, well, dwarf stuff. The second night appears to be going the same way as the first, peaceful drifting in the middle of the ocean. In the early hours of the morning, Bells is woken by a gurgle and a splash. She peers down from her perch in the crow's nest and sees that one of the guards that was standing on the main deck is missing. Where they should be, hideous fish people are boarding the ship, weapons drawn. Bells shrieks in a weird gibberish and then imitates an alarm bell as loud as she possibly can. Dagg wakes with a start.
It's a mutiny. Throw Wolfgar overboard.
Dagg excitedly runs up to the deck, closely followed by Murithi and Fargas. The dwarf crew are caught off guard and are getting their gear on as fast as possible.
Oh, it's fish people. Let's cook them for dinner.
I guess that's one way to handle aquatic invaders. The attacking force is formidable. 18 smaller fish people, one magic-y fish person, and a fish person who looks like he only eats steroids. Ever. Bells throws herself down from the crow's nest and joins the melee, which is complicated by the wood of the ship. Can't use fire, not that the party is particularly loaded with fire damage. Withhold person, the magic-y fish person concentrated on keeping Bells locked down for most of the fight, but Dagg unveiled a new secret weapon while Fargas and Murithi provided him with cover. Enemies abound. If you're not familiar with this spell, it causes you to see everyone nearby as an enemy, regardless if they are actually an ally. Dagg, of course, targets steroided fishman, and the results are predictable and horrifying. You know the feeling when you're ambushing enemies and one of your own does more damage to your allies than your enemies? Yep, this particular monster had a triple multi-attack, pretty decent damage, and started killing its own followers left and right. After the party and dwarf crew slaughtered half the fish people's number, the remaining attackers threw themselves off the ship into the murky water. If this attack is an indicator of things to come, we're in for a fun ride. The rest of the morning after the fish people attack was fortunately uneventful, but no one slept easily. Bells the kenku monk kept a weathered eye on the horizon and the ship's deck. Eventually, the beautiful morning sun breaks over the quiet, dark ocean and fills the sky with a radiant pinkish-red hue. The light of dawn illuminates a badly damaged ship drifting on the ocean current. It is missing its masts, sails, and looks like it might come apart at any minute. The perfect place to go retrieve some treasure. Getting onto the ship is a slightly complicated affair because Wolfgar is afraid of going too close to the wreck with his own vessel. The party is sent to the Emperor in a rowboat manned by a pair of burly dwarves. Having grabbed the grappling hooks Albrecht made available, the party boards the derelict ship and assesses their surroundings. The Emperor's upper deck slope gently towards the ship's port side. The forecastle and quarterdeck are empty, and short wooden stumps are all that remain of the ship's masts. The double doors leading to cabins fore and aft appear intact, as does the metal grate in the deck that offers access to the lower decks. Aside from the rhythmic creak of the ship's badly weathered timbers, all seems quiet. The party takes a brief look around the ship's main deck before heading into the aft cabin. A rough stone altar dominates the cabin, and strange markings cover its surface. Dried mud cakes the floor around it, while humanoid skulls ring the wall above, each mounted on a wooden spike. The corners of this room are piled high with garbage and debris. Crudely cut wooden logs, smashed furniture, torn sacks, shattered crates, and small piles of dried palm fronds. A staircase descends from the southeast corner and an acrid odor fills the air. Dagg and Bells venture into the cabin and are immediately attacked by a giant spider and a netter cap. Bells is pissed about the surprise attack, but while she gets webbed, Murithi and Fargas run over to help just as more spiders appear from below deck. After squashing some bugs, progression further down into the ship's hold is slow as everyone is extra suspicious of additional surprise attacks. Bells peers around a doorframe to see palm fronds are piled up in one corner of a room to make a crude bed. Nearby, a stone-tipped wooden spear and an oblong shield lean against the wall. The shield bears the symbol of a humanoid skull with spiders crawling from its eye sockets. Two weathered humanoid skulls hang from wooden pegs on the wall. The room also contains a crazed-looking half-orc and three large spiders. Two of the spiders look normal, but one spider is white with blue markings on its face and mandible. The half-orc hurls a ball of fire at Bells before Dagg attempts to defuse the situation.
Hello? What did you say your name was?
I didn't say my name, but you must leave this place! Defilers! Intruders!
That's fine. We're not really beholden to anything. We were hired to get something, but honestly, I was planning to steal it if it was in my best interest anyway. So, I mean...
I like you.
Oh, good. Oh, thanks.
Come here, little goblin. Come into the room. My spiders won't hurt you. You don't trust me?
Why do I need to come in there?
So I can see you.
Okay, you will behold Dagg the Everlasting's beauty.
Dagg walks cautiously into the room. The spiders eye him hungrily, saliva dripping from their dark mandibles. But they do nothing.
What is there to steal here, goblin?
I don't know. He wasn't specific.
He who?
Birdman, do you remember his name?
Fancy.
A fancy dwarf.
A fancy dwarf? I hate dwarves!
I do too. Speaking of which, if there were any dwarves on the ship, we don't need them to come in.
Fargas slowly and quietly clanks into a separate room, not wanting to make an already tenuous situation worse.
No. Okay, right now. I also hate dwarves. Never have associated with them in my life. So, you know. But the problem is, the ship is going down. It's listing to the starboard side.
What? You can't be serious.
I'm serious as a heart attack.
Dagg and his expert persuasion easily convince the half-orc that the ship's doom is imminent.
I gotta get off this ship!
Yeah, gotta get off and get your spider friends. They'll drown if you leave them. Why were you on the ship? What were you doing here?
The half-orc and his giant spiders run past the party, managing not to catch sight of Fargas as they vanish up the stairs to the main deck. Meanwhile, Bells has taken notice of all the little spiders in the room and is filling a sack with their bodies. Snack time! The floor of the adjacent chamber is covered with runes written in blood. A circle has been carved into the floor's wooden planks, and spiderwebs cover the walls and ceiling. Two humanoid-sized bundles attached to the ceiling writhe as hundreds of tiny spiders swarm over them. Bells cuts the first bundle down and carefully slices it open. She uncovers the body of a girl who is still alive, but barely. The child gurgles on her own blood and reaches a hand weakly towards Bells before she expires and is still. While this group may be half evil, the child's death was poorly received. For the next bundle, Bells takes precautions. She has Fargas heal the occupant before she carefully lowers the bundle to the ground and slices it open. Inside is a young woman and she, understandably, panics upon being released. Seems like this poor woman got mixed up with the wrong crowd somewhere.
Fargas!
Do something!
Kenku voices not soothing.
Ah, lassie.
You're down from the web.
Come join us. We're getting off this ship.
This woman, despite clearly having reservations, doesn't really have many options. On the plus side, this group of misfits did save her from being eaten. Dagg ditches the spider room and finds the next hallway coated in spiderwebs.
This isn't great.
Dagg carefully walks down the dark hallway, ready to run if attacked. Nothing jumps out at him before he reaches the end, and that's where Dagg discovers a spiderweb-covered trapdoor. With no hesitation, he opens the trapdoor to reveal a room below.
Hey, stupids! Get over here and look.
This lowest deck runs the length of the ship and features no bulkheads or walls. Dark, murky seawater fills it to a depth of 3 feet, sloshing against old, moldering crates piled against the ship's port hull.
Did the guy ever say what we were looking for?
A chest.
Only to be used by him.
Fancy.
The water is deep enough that the party will have to partially submerge their bodies in order to locate the chest, assuming the chest is even here. No one present is above 5.5 feet tall, so 3 feet of dark, murky seawater is a tall order, so to speak.
Fargas, come over here and protect Dagg.
Ah, Dagg. You're settling. You're nervous, laddie.
You're nervous, laddie. Stupid. Go down there.
All right. Hey, Murithi.
What?
If something moves, shoot it.
Murithi pulls out her bow and knocks an arrow before Fargas carefully descends the ladder, stepping onto the only unflooded area of the cargo hold. Bells and Dagg decide they want to question the young woman they rescued to get more information about the ship and its lack of crew. Dagg goes first, and the woman hides her face, so Bells takes a turn and has a bit more success. The woman reveals she was captured in a recent attack where spiders and a vicious orc slaughtered most of the ship and took few prisoners. Those taken prisoner were, perhaps obviously, spider food. Dagg gets bored of asking questions and leaves the room, heading towards the trapdoor into the cargo hold. He hops down the ladder with Dagg-like gusto, sees a crate marked with the letter A, and stops. A just so happens to start the name of their benefactor, Abrek.
A for Alden? Alimer? Avocado? Do you guys know any other A names?
Abrek?
Oh, you're right. Smash it open. Let's get it.
Bells and Murithi descend the ladder into the cargo hold, leaving no one to watch the trap door or young woman above. Bells, ready to get on with her day, takes a crowbar and smashes the crate open, revealing an impermeable blue chest with no visible lock. As if on cue, gurgling noises echo from the other end of the cargo hold as four disgusting undead things burst out of the water. The undead howl with joy and charge the party, reaching out with their disgusting, deadly claws. Thinking quickly, Murithi wades into the bilge water and seizes part of the treasure box.
Fargas, get over here and help me lift the
Ah, lassie, why do you gotta be so rude?
The pair manage to hoist the chest and make haste for the ladder, leaving Bells and Dagg to face the approaching undead. To make matters worse, the ship rocks violently as an unknown force batters it. Several cracks appear in the already damaged wood, causing more water to spill into the cargo hold. The undead do not slow their advance as Bells and Dagg race to leave.
Bye.
Dagg climbs the ladder out of the hold and runs down the passageway leading up to the main deck.
Dagg, don't run off. We need you to lock the trapdoor behind us.
Oh, sorry. Ready.
Bells hops straight up through the trapdoor and runs down the passageway ahead of Murithi and Fargas, who are still lugging the heavy chest.
Locked. Stupid undead.
The howling of the undead can be heard through the trapdoor as the pounding of appendages shakes the swollen wood in its frame. Luckily, it holds. For now. The ship jolts violently for a second time, and now the party has to make dexterity checks to stay on their feet. If they fail, they'll fall heavily and take bludgeoning damage. Whatever is attacking the ship clearly means business. Additional structural damage allows water to seep into the passageway all around the party. Little spiders are running everywhere, trying to escape the water. Bells, thinking quickly, puts her spider sack on the wall and runs down the passageway, scooping up a sweet hoard of snacks. At least someone has their priorities straight. In the scramble to climb the stairs, Murithi and Fargas accidentally block Dagg's passage to the upper floors.
Ah, get out of my way!
The party makes its way through the corridors as the ship continues to pitch and shudder as it is violently attacked. After what feels like ages, they reach the exterior of the ship and behold a terrible sight. A gigantic octopus is trying to drag the ship below the water. The Emperor is currently half submerged in icy seawater, and spiders are running about the main deck hopelessly, trying to find a way to safe, dry land. Then, at the worst of times, the party is greeted by an unfortunately familiar face.
Goblin! What have you done to the ship?
I warned you to get off of it because something was f***ing happening to it.
You did! But how are we going to get off of it alive?
How did you get onto it alive?
I took the ship! It belongs to me! Me!
Did you put any lifeboats on it?
What's a lifeboat?
So that's a no then.
Bells whispers an idea into Dag's ear and Dagg gets a horrible grin on his goblin-y face.
Why don't you go steer the ship? I'll go fix the problem.
Dagg rolls a 29 for his deception, and the half-orc is convinced. The half-orc breaks into a panic sprint, taking his pet spiders up to the steering platform.
Fargas, flag down your friends in the boat.
In the distance, the party sees a rowboat start to approach the Emperor with all haste. But they're really far away, considering the current state of affairs. You know, with the octopus destroying the ship and all. Murithi takes a look over the edge of the ship and gasps.
Guys, it's big and it doesn't look like it's going to stop. Figure something out.
Dagg does a very loud performance so the creature can hear him, even though its head is underwater, and then Dagg uses dissonant whispers to send it scurrying away into the darkness after it fails its wisdom check. It will be back, but that's in the future, not now.
Little goblin! This steering is not helping the ship!
Just keep doing it!
The half-orc looks very skeptical about Dagg's decision, but Dagg's deception wins out again.
Alright, but it's not looking good!
It'll look bad before it looks good.
How did you take the ship in the first place?
It was mine for the taking! We won! They lost!
How did you get here?
I sailed it! I don't know how! Sailed it?
The ship? From where?
The ship! From my island!
Ship landed. Your island.
You took the ship?
Yes!
and they're all dead. Dead, yes, very dead. Ha 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 ha.
This ship was lost at sea before it made its way to the Half-Orc's Island, where the denizens are crazed demon worshippers. Among the several factions were worshippers of Loth, demon queen of spiders. From personal experience, anytime Loth gets involved means you're going to have a really bad time. The demon worshippers killed the sailors and took over the ship, but ended up infighting over control of the ship. The half-orc managed to get the ship away from the island with many of his faction alive, but they slowly turned on and ate each other over a period of months. Unfortunately for the crazed survivor, no one in the party particularly likes half-orcs. The ship shudders violently again, and the poor woman is killed as she smashes onto the deck. Her lifeless corpse slides off the boat and into the water.
Oh, goddammit.
Goblin! I am concerned!
Just pull the steering wheel all the way to the port side. All the way to the starboard side.
Dagg has yet to miss a deception roll. These DCs are set at 25, considering the severity of the situation. It's just ridiculous.
All right, Goblin! I trust you!
Yes, trust Dagg.
Dagg!
Tell everyone to shush, and I'll cast Pass Without Trace.
Oh, be quiet, you losers.
I cannot be quieter, Goblin!
Yeah, sorry, Bells. It was a good thought, but this octopus has nothing but destruction on its mind as it collides with the ship again, causing it to violently tremble as more worn timbers groan loudly and shatter.
Goblin! This doesn't seem to be working!
Well, now that you have successfully steered us, you need to hide. You and your spiders. This is what we're doing now.
Where would I hide?
Just be quiet. Just be really quiet. Lay on the ground, pretend that you don't exist. That'll be good enough.
The party hears a thud, thud, thud as the half-orc and his spiders hit the deck.
I admire your enthusiasm, certainly.
The deck pitches again, and the half-orc gets bludgeoned quite badly.
Goblin! This didn't work!
Just be quiet.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
All right! I hope this works. I'm depending on you, Goblin.
It's currently working, so shut the hell up.
The rowboat is getting closer as seawater has covered the deck and is starting to reach the stairs leading up to the half-orc and his spiders. Can you not go faster?
Goblin! This isn't working!
Oh my god, if you keep doubting me, it's not going to work.
All right, I'll be quiet again. We need to figure something out.
Yeah, I'm figuring it out. I'm a mastermind. Just don't worry about it. I told you there was going to be a problem, right? And here we are.
Have you any suggestions for an action, half-orc?
The rowboat is slowly approaching swim distance, and the water on the deck is now 1 foot deep. It's almost time to get the heck out of here. As if to remind everyone who's in charge, the octopus attacks the ship again, and the half-orc gets a full face of deck timbers.
Goblin! Goblin! I insist this isn't working!
It just gets worse until it suddenly works. That's how all the best plans go.
I don't understand how that's supposed to help me!
Just keep steering.
You want me to steer now?
Steer again.
Which way?
Starboard.
Influenced by Dagg the Deceiver, the half-orc furiously turns the ship's wheel to starboard. Fargas has started losing his footing and is getting knocked about by the octopus's attacks. This wouldn't be a problem, except he's one of the people supporting the chest. Dagg whips out some bagpipes and inspires Fargas with some amazing music. Bells takes full advantage of the lull in the ship shaking to tie a rope securely to the chest so it can be safely put in the rowboat. The ship suddenly rocks again, 2.5 feet of water on the deck.
Orc!
Do you have a way off the ship?
I don't have a way off the ship! Goblin! I'm very, very concerned!
But look at my dance!
It's a good dance, but how are we getting out alive?
You just gotta keep steering.
The half-orc, unobservant as ever, has not yet seen the rowboat, which is finally close enough to where the party can board before they get dragged to the icy depths.
Eh! Dwarves, catch the box! Eh, don't throw a box!
Why not?
Set it gently.
Fine.
Lower the box. Dagg is still playing his bagpipes and dancing, fully in his element. The box is safely lowered into the rowboat, but the crazed half-orc finally notices his potential escape vector.
Goblin! Is that your boat?
No, it's not my boat.
I'm getting that boat! It's for me! I will take it!
No, that's not part of the plan.
I will take it!
Someone punt him off the boat.
Oh, no one. Oh well.
Murithi throws Dagg into the boat while Fargas grabs Bells and jumps. Murithi climbs aboard and Bells casts darkness to obscure the boat from the half-orc.
Goblin!
Bye.
The rowboat begins quickly heading away from the giant cephalopod, the destroyed ship, and the crazed half-orc. Not a few moments pass before the party hears a splash in the water as the half-orc throws himself overboard and tries to find the rowboat. They were celebrating the half-orc's probable death, but they hear his voice resonate quite loudly.
You will not leave me here, little goblin!
Why is it just me he wants?
The half-orc has managed to locate the boat and is aggressively swimming after it.
For the love of God, everybody row!
I'll get your boat! Oh!
Ah. Is he a friend of yours?
Definitely not. We tried to leave him behind.
Yeah, he'll try to kill you.
Oh, that's not a good sign.
And he hates dwarves, so...
And so the battle against the demon-worshipping half-orc begins. The goal is obviously to not let him board the rowboat for fear he'll try to kill everyone on it and capsize the boat with his efforts. Murithi starts strafing him from the boat, launching arrow after arrow and missing. Basically, all of her arrows went into the water. Someone did not pray to the dice gods. Fargas is holding the chest in place while Dagg and Bells figure out how they're gonna stop this murderous psychopath. Dagg uses dissonant whispers to make the druid go away, but of course, the damn druid saves against the fear. The half-orc gets close enough to the rowboat that Bells can start hurling darts with wild abandon. It's mostly thanks to her when the party watches him sink below the waves, mouthing obscenities with his final breaths.
Good riddance.
Bells snacks on her spiders until the dwarves row the party back to Wolfgar's ship. A few uneventful days of sea travel later, the party returns to Gibna's port. Abrek is delighted to have his treasure chest, and the party receive their promised 10,000 gold, split four ways, but still. Not bad for a mid-level adventure. I am delighted to inform you that this is not the last you'll see of Dagg, Murithi, Bells, and Fargas. There are more adventures on their way, but don't hold your breath, because you and I both know how frequently these get published. In the next adventure, the party is hired to visit an abbey infested with undead and cultists. Well, they sure know how to party. A special thanks to my lovely patrons for helping make these videos possible. And thank you all so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please hit that subscribe button, smash that like button, share my video on your Twitter, Facebook, or other social media, and make the leap to become one of my patrons on Patreon. As a patron, you gain exclusive access to my after-the-episode content and other benefits as well. I'll see you all next time.